got millions, I got riches building in my DNA. I got dark, I got evil that rot inside my DNA. I got off, I got trouble, some heart inside my DNA. I just win again, then win again, like Wimbledon I serve. Yeah, that's him again, the sound, the engine in is like a bird. You see fireworks and Corvette tire skirt, the boulevard. I know how you work, I know just...
Howdy, today I'm Flippin Science, looking at DNA. Thanks to Sam Moyle for making this PowerPoint presentation. So science understands what we're going to look at. DNA stores and transmits genetic information. It's a double helix. The structure is different in eukaryotes and prokaryotes. Replication of DNA allows for genetic information to be inherited. There's base pairing rules in DNA, and explains semi-conservative replication. So DNA is constructed of two complementary strands. Not complementary as in being nice, complementary as in matching each other. It's in a double helix. It's made up of alternative deoxyribose and phosphate groups as a backbone. Attached to that backbone are nitrogenous bases, which are A, T, G, and C, adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine, all the way around for those. Adenine always pairs with thymine, guanine always pairs with cytosine, and these bases are connected by hydrogen bonds between the two strands. So if we look at the structure, we've got the sugar phosphate backbone, we've got our nitrogenous bases, guanine, cytosine, adenine, thymine. Between these, there are hydrogen bonds which holds the whole structure together. In this diagram, we can see the alternative sugar phosphate groups. So here's a sugar group, here's a phosphate group, here's a sugar group, here's a phosphate group, here's a sugar group, here's a phosphate group. And attached to our sugar, in this case deoxyribose, we have the nitrogenous bases, and they're connected with hydrogen bonds, which are reasonably weak and relatively easy to break. And that's one of the important parts of why DNA is structured the way it is and how useful it is when it's structured that way. So eukaryotic cells need to have two or more chromosomes. In humans, we've got 46. That DNA we call the genetic code. The DNA is found in the nucleus. It contains all the instructions for how the cell functions. The information can be copied and passed down from one generation to the next, so it's hereditary. It can be passed on. Eukaryotic DNA is linear, so it's in one big long line, and prokaryotic DNA is in circulars, in loops. Also, when we talk about prokaryotic DNA, we should mention that it isn't bound in the nucleus. It floats around the cytoplasm, or cytosol of the cell. And like I said, it's in loops. It's not in long lines. It's not linear like eukaryotic DNA. When undergoing replication, the DNA condenses down into a thicker rod, which is the typical X shape that we think of chromosomes, and it does this because of a protein called chromatin that's present there. On the chromosomes, there are structures called genes. Genes carry the information to make a polypeptide, which is a protein. Each gene has a specific location on a chromosome, we call that a locus, and you have many loci. So in humans, on each chromosome, there are several thousand genes. So human cells might have 20 to 25,000 genes inside them. So each gene has a specific locus. So for example, here's the location of the cystic fibrosis gene. It's found on chromosome 7. And a different gene, like Huntington's, this is found on chromosome 4. So if we see here, the locus for Huntington's disease is up here at the top of chromosome 4. So in humans, we have 46 chromosomes, which are found in 23 pairs. There's 22 autosomal chromosomes, which aren't associated with sex, and then we have two sex chromosomes. So if you're female, you have XX. If you're male, you have XY. We take pictures of chromosomes when they condense down, and we get this familiar shape here. And we call this a karyotype, where we show all the chromosomes of a person. In this case, this person has trisomy 21, so that means they would have Down syndrome. We call cells that contain all these 23 pairs somatic cells, which are different from sex cells. So let's have a look at replication. So DNA is made up of two complementary strands. So we need to copy DNA to pass information from one generation to the next. So it's made up of two complementary strands of nucleotides, like we said before, AT and G and C, and then they're joined by hydrogen bonds between them. An enzyme called DNA helicase unzips those hydrogen bonds between the two strands, and then free nucleotides bind to the complementary nucleotide partners. So if you have an A exposed, AT will come in and join to that. And then you have another enzyme called DNA ligase, which joins the sugar phosphate backbones together to make a new backbone. So here's a picture showing this. So here we have our two strands of DNA that we're going to copy, unzipped by the helicase enzyme, so then we get these two strands. You have free nucleotides coming in, and they're binding to the complementary partner, so adenine binds to thymine, guanine pairs with cytosine. This is done by an enzyme called DNA polymerase. And then what's not shown here is another enzyme comes in called ligase, which joins the sugar phosphate backbones of the new strands together. That's DNA replication. We call this semi-conservative replication because when we separate our two strands of DNA and we get our new copies of the DNA made, in each of the new copies there's one bit of the old strand and one new strand. So it's semi-conserved, so it's half kept, I guess is a way of looking at it. So the daughter DNA molecules are half old molecule, half new molecules. So that's why we call it semi-conservative replication. So let's see how DNA does its job. So you have three letters on DNA that we call a triplet. Each of those triplets produces what's called a codon on mRNA, and a codon codes for an amino acid. So three letters in a DNA triplet codes for a codon for an amino acid. So proteins are made up of amino acids, and we use 20 amino acids to make all the proteins in our body. So we need to give our ribosomes a code to say which amino acid to join to which amino acid to join to which amino acid to make the final protein. So as a base triplet on DNA, which produces a codon and mRNA, those codons are read by ribosomes to produce the proteins that we need. There's also start and stop codons, which tell the ribosome when to start and when to stop producing a protein too. Now these are all in RNA, and the key with RNA is instead of having thymine, they have uracil. So that's why there's all these U's here. Normally we would have T's because it's DNA, but we're looking at the mRNA codons, so we have U's instead. So if I was wanting to join a phenylalanine to a leucine, for example, I would have an mRNA codon of UUU and an mRNA codon of UUA next to each other on my mRNA molecule. This all makes sense in a second. There's 64 possible combinations if you have three letters in your code, and that's more than enough to cover the 20 amino acids plus start and stop that we can use to make up our proteins. So let's see how this protein making works. So we need to have DNA turned into RNA, and then the RNA turned into protein. So this step here, DNA turning to RNA, we call transcription, and this step here where we turn RNA into the protein is called translation. Both of these processes involve RNA, like I mentioned before. So messenger RNA is produced from the DNA. The messenger RNA makes its way out of the nucleus to a ribosome, and then the information from the mRNA is turned into the protein. In that step in translation, there's a molecule called tRNA which brings the amino acids into the ribosome. So RNA is like DNA, it's a nucleic acid. There's a few differences. One, rather than having deoxyribose as the sugar in DNA, there's ribose. RNA is single-stranded, not double-stranded. In RNA, uracil replaces thymine. The other thing is that RNA isn't confined to the nucleus. It moves from the nucleus out to the extranuclear space so that ribosomes can produce the proteins. So let's have an analogy. So the DNA is the blueprint that tells you how to make something, but you want to keep that safe. So if we're using a building analogy, you would keep that safe in an office. But you need to have a copy of that information so that you can make what you want to make. So a copy is made of the instructions, and that makes its way out into the area where you're making your building, for example. So mRNA is the copy. mRNA moves from the nucleus out to the extranuclear space to make the protein. So it's a working copy of the instructions. So the first step in protein synthesis is called transcription. So a complementary version of the DNA is made on mRNA, and that makes its way from the nucleus outside the nucleus to a ribosome. So, in transcription, a section of DNA containing the instructions for the protein to be made, it's unzipped, so similar to in replication, but it's only the gene that we're unzipping, not the entire molecule of DNA. The two strands separate, and at the triplet TAC on DNA, which codes for the amino acid methionine, complementary free base nucleotides start lining up using the DNA as a template. So we follow the base pairing rules, except that uracil takes the place of thymine. So we have another enzyme coming in called RNA polymerase, which links the nucleotides together to make a single chain of mRNA. That chain leaves the nucleus via nuclear pores and goes into the cytoplasm to find a ribosome. And the DNA zips up itself. Let's have a look at this. So here we have the green enzyme, RNA polymerase. It's unzipped the DNA. We have a template strand, so this is the one that contains the code for the protein that we want to make. We get RNA nucleotides coming in, and they're following base pairing rules. So where adenine would normally bind with thymine, it binds with uracil instead, and guanine binds with cytosine. So we get those complementary base pairing rules being followed, except we swap U for T. And once we've got the coding done, then the DNA zips back up together. We need to then translate the mRNA that's being produced, so this happens at the ribosome. Ribosomes are made up of ribosomal RNA, so it's another version of RNA, as well as some proteins. So the mRNA codons are translated into an amino acid sequence that we can then join together to make up our protein. So we need something to bring in those amino acids into the ribosome, and that's called tRNA. So down here we have our ribosome. At our ribosome, the mRNA feeds through. We get a tRNA molecules, which carry the amino acid that we need, and that matches up with the codon. On the tRNA, we have the structure called an anticodon, which is the opposite of the codon on the mRNA. So again, we're following base pairing rules. Adenine binds with uracil, guanine binds with cytosine, because it's RNA as well. So there's no T's here, there's U's instead of T's. So at the ribosome, we get a codon being read. A tRNA molecule, which has the complementary three-letter sequence, the anticodon, comes in, drops off its amino acid, and comes out. And the ribosome joins those amino acids together to make our protein chain. So for each amino acid, there's at least one tRNA molecule that matches up to that amino acid. tRNA, it's about 80 nucleotides long, and we call it a cloverleaf shape. At one end, there's these exposed triplets, which we call the anticodon. So this is the opposite of the codon on the mRNA. And at the other end, we have the amino acid being attached. So in this case, the anticodon is ACC. It's carrying tryptophan, which is an amino acid. The codon for this would be the opposite, so it would be UGG. And the DNA molecule, the DNA triplet that started this off, would be ACC. So that's the way that they relate to each other. So for each codon in mRNA, there's a complementary tRNA molecule. And that tRNA brings in the amino acid, and we get our long protein strand being produced from that. So the amino acids are joined together by an enzyme just outside the ribosome to make the polypeptide chain. So it makes what's called a peptide link or an amide bond in chemistry to join those amino acids together. So let's summarize the entire process. So we have DNA. We need to make a working copy of DNA to make our protein. So we get transcription happening in the nucleus where the DNA unzips, and we make a copy of the DNA triplets on an mRNA sequence, and that mRNA sequence is made up of a series of codons. That mRNA makes its way out of the nucleus to a ribosome, where it is read off by the ribosome. tRNA molecules, which have a complementary anticodon to the codons on the mRNA, carry amino acids into the ribosome. They drop them off, and then they make their way out. We get the amino acids joining together, and we make a long sequence of those. They're joined together by an enzyme to make the final protein that we wanted to make. Now, just some complications. All the DNA in a gene is transcribed into mRNA, but some of the mRNA isn't required to make the final protein. So there's this extra DNA in there that isn't useful for making the protein. The bits that code for a gene and are turned into a protein we call exons, and the non-coding parts we call introns. So what we need to do is get rid of our introns before we make our final mRNA to translate into protein. So to make our what we call our mature mRNA strand, we need to remove the introns from that. So we start with our primary mRNA, which has the introns inside. We need to remove those introns before we translate. And when we remove those introns, we get what we call mature mRNA. Now, the way this is done is basically molecular scissors come in, cut out the bits that we don't want, and then join back together. We splice back together the bits that we do want to produce the mature mRNA. And our final mature mRNA is ready to be translated into a protein. Now, the way this happens is quite complex, but we just need to keep it very, very simple here. So from our DNA strand, an mRNA copy is made. The introns are spliced out of that primary mRNA sequence to produce mature mRNA, which is then used to produce our proteins. So today on Flippin Science, we looked at what DNA does. That's it, Flippin Science Day. See ya.